Pastor John has mentioned, we've got 2 weeks to do two churches, finish up Philadelphia and finish up Laodicea. So we're not going to spend too much time, really any time, in review of Philadelphia. But let's just read that letter to the church of Philadelphia, and then we'll pray, and then we'll dive right in, starting at verse 12, actually. So just in review, we'll read the letter itself. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, the words of the Holy One, the true One, who has the key of David, who opens and no one will shut, who shuts and no one opens. I know your works. Behold, I have set before you an open door which no one is able to shut. I know that you have but little power, and yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. Behold, I will make some of those of the synagogue of Satan who say they are Jews but are not, and are not but lie. Behold, I will make them come and bow down before your feet, and they will learn that I have loved you, because you have kept my word about patient endurance. I will keep you from the hour of trial that is coming on the whole world, to try those who dwell on the earth. I am coming soon. Hold fast what you have, so that no one may seize your crown. To the one who conquers, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God. Never shall he go out of it. And I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which comes down from my God out of heaven, and my new name. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just ask that you will open our ears, that you will open our hearts, that you will make us receptive. Lord, may we be ready. May you find us as ready ground for your seed to grow. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to pick up where we left off 3 weeks ago, and that was Revelation chapter 3, verse 12. And we have, like I said, we only have this week and next to work through the rest of the Philadelphia and Laodicea. So starting at verse 12, the one who conquers, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and never shall he go out of it. To this faithful, suffering church, we talked about Philadelphia's faithfulness. To this faithful and suffering church, Jesus makes this beautiful promise. To these Christians who probably associate pillars with power and strength and wealth, basically everything that they themselves lack, Jesus says, you will be a pillar. A pillar is permanent. It is part of the very structure of the building. It's strong, immovable, dependable, supportive, and beautiful. And Jesus promises them that he will make the overcomer a pillar in the temple of his God, a fixture in the temple of his God. What an amazing promise. We all know people who are fixtures in the body of Christ, who are always steadfast. Even when they go through some stuff, we know that they're steadfast. And we know people who really aren't. We know people who are pillars, and we know people who are really not pillars in contrast. Who do we run to for strength? Who do we go to learn from, to lean on? We go to the pillars. And Jesus says he's going to make the overcomer a pillar in the temple of his God. And I see in this promise a reflection of the prayer of David in Psalm 27, which says, one thing I ask of the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. To gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. This promise is a promise of everlasting, intimate fellowship with the Most High. There's no greater promise. There's no greater destiny for the Christian. And then he says, and I will write on him the name of my God. repeatedly in Revelation, there's this image of writing in a book or blotting out from a book. And we have already talked about perhaps this using this familiar image is Jesus referring to the present reality in the Roman towns of the Roman registers and their book, from which much of the hardships placed upon Christians of the time sprang. They were familiar with that book. The tax man's book said this person owes this, and that person owes that. This person needs to swear, and this person is exempt from swearing. The book is the record. But now we see Jesus writes on the overcomer themselves. We've seen him mention writing and blotting out throughout all the letters. And now he says, I'm going to write on you. It's on them that God's name and the new city's name and Jesus' new name are all written. They have become the very witness, the very record, the very story of the work of God. Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, he says, you yourselves are our letter, inscribed on our hearts, known and read by everyone. It is clear that you are a letter from Christ, the result of our ministry, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of human heart. On the overcomer, those pillars in God's eternal temple, will be written the everlasting mark of ownership. These ones are shown to all creation to be bearers of the name. They are children of God. They are co-heirs with Christ. They are his and he is theirs. They themselves are the very record of the work of God in their lives, written on them for all to see is God's name and the name of the new city and the new name of Christ. What a glorious promise. But it also begs the question, doesn't it? What are our lives witnesses to now? We need to prayerfully ask that question every day, I think. What name is written on our life for the world to see? What do our actions tell our children, our family, our neighbors, our church, our community? Do our lives bear the name of God for all to see? Or do they tell a different story altogether? These ones bear the name of God, their Father, written on them by none other than God the Son. They also bear the name of Jesus, by whose blood they were adopted into the family of God. And they bear the name of the new city that they are members of and co-heirs of, that they are rulers with Christ. What do our lives, this is supposed to be talking about us, but is that name apparent today for all the world to see? That's God's will for the Christian. He wants us to be known as his, not known as something else, not labeled with a bunch of other labels, a bunch of other stickers. He wants us to be known as his. So that when the people see us, all they see is what? Him. This is not on my notes, and I usually get in trouble when I go off my notes, but I won't make this very long. We all struggle with, we're all familiar with that statement that Paul says, I became all things to all men in order to win some. And I think there's a misunderstanding of what that is. Some people think that Paul is kind of being like, he's being two-faced. He's, acting like, the cool kids in one moment and the geeks the next and the jocks the next. You probably knew people like that, or maybe you were people like that in your school. Try to fit into whatever crowd so that you could relate. But I don't think that's actually what's going on. I think Paul says, I became like a Jew in order to reach the Jew, and I became like a Greek in order to reach the Greeks. What I think he's trying to say there is, I didn't have anything in my life, anything in me, that was overtly an offense to the people I was trying to reach, other than the gospel. What Paul was known for was not his stance on this point or that point or that other point. He was known for Jesus. And that's it. We love our stances. We love our convictions, our commitments. I'm this. I think Paul would say, well, you need to take that commitment, that stance, and if it gets in the way of the witness, of your witness to the people you're trying to reach for the gospel, you need to hold on loosely. The name that is to be written on you for the world to see is the name of God, the name of Christ. And that's a promise for what's going to come in the future. So you might not want to be that right now, but someday you're going to be. You're going to be known for whose you are. So verse 13. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He ends with the same thing he says for all the seven churches. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to his church, to the churches. As always, our Lord finishes with his letter with this exhortation. Just a couple things. We haven't spoke about this exhortation yet. We need to note that hear does not simply refer to perception. It refers to reception as well. Not just perception, but reception. All right. Anybody who's a parent or a teacher knows there's a difference between hearing and receiving. The Lord isn't just talking about auditory hearing here. He's talking about receiving as well. All right. I'm reminded of what oftentimes occurs after a particularly challenging sermon or lesson. People will often come up to me and voice what they were thinking, and they'll ask, Pastor Brian, was that for me? Or for someone in particular, because I didn't like it. They don't say the last part, but that's really what they're saying. Who's that for? Because they're asking themselves during the message, who's he talking to? We like to say or think amen to the things we agree with from Scripture. And we tend to do one of these. To things in Scripture that we don't like so much. Jesus is not saying, hey, if you agree with all I said, great. That's not what he's saying. He's saying, this is for you. This is for you. Hear what the Spirit is saying to you personally through it. The letter might not be addressed to you. So next time you're wondering, who's he talking to? Remember, the letter might not be addressed to you. But you sure can allow the Holy Spirit to apply some area of your life. Apply it to some area of your life. That's the way that the Lord wants us to receive the word. To hear it. To receive it. To respond to it. Not just to perceive, but to receive. All right? So that's, we're ending there with, we're ending Philadelphia, and we're going to move on to Laodicea. So we want to turn to verse 14 and read to verse 22. I think it'd be kind of neat if someone else read that passage for us. If you'd like to read, if you feel so led or would like to, stand up and read that for us. Revelation chapter 3, verse 14 through 22.
And to the angel of the church in Laodicea write, the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of God's creation. I know your works. You are neither cold nor hot. Would that you were either cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. For you say, I am rich, I have prospered, and I need nothing, not realizing that you are wretched, pitiable, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined by fire, so that you may be rich, and white garments, so that you may clothe yourself, and the shame of your nakedness may not be seen, and salve to anoint your eyes, so that you may see. Those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him and he with me. The one who conquers, I will grant him to sit with me on my throne, as I also conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches.
Amen. Thank you so much. Well, because of Jesus' dynamic rebuke to this church in Laodicea, this church is one of the most famous of Revelation, if not the most, after Philadelphia, because we know the name. Laodicea is what pops into most people's heads when they think of the churches of Revelation, because Jesus' rebuke is so stark here. So let's begin, as usual, with just some history about Laodicea. The name Laodicea means justice of the people. And Laodicea was a banking center in the region of Asia Minor. And it was planted on the main trade routes of the day. And it was known for its large marketplace, its booming economy. And Laodicea was destroyed by an earthquake in AD 70. And the Roman historian Tacitus wrote that after the earthquake, Rome offered to rebuild Laodicea, but it was so, because it was so influential in the Roman economy of that region, they offered to rebuild it. But the people of the city declined and saying that they were wealthy enough, they were capable enough to restore their own city. Thank you very much. And so they did that. They restored their own city without Roman help. So the city of Laodicea was located in the Lycus River Valley. And because of what Jesus says about its lukewarmness, people have postulated a couple things. And number one, that even though it was a river valley, the city itself was not beside a water source of any kind, but the water from the city was piped in from the two rivers that flanked it, from the Asopus and the Carpus. And others suggest, and so we see archaeological evidence of an aqueduct in the Laodicean ruins. And other people suggest that the water of the city was piped in from the hot springs of Hierapolis, located northwest of the city. So there's two theories that the water was piped in from the rivers nearby, and others were saying it was piped in from the hot springs. And so by the time the water reached the city, it was lukewarm. That's just what we hear most of the time, that the water of the city was lukewarm because it wasn't hot from the hot springs, it wasn't cold from the river, it was lukewarm. I'm sure that many of us have heard these mentioned as illustration. And interestingly, though, neither seems to be grounded in actual history of the city, or the history of the records of people who visited there or worked there. There actually are inscriptions on the ruins of the city that mention the high quality and the sweetness of the piped-in water. And we might think that as rich as the citizens of Laodicea were, and how important quality water was for life, that they would have insisted on high quality water. All right. Clean, pure water was probably insisted on by those who were as wealthy as those who were in Laodicea. And so that those ideas about the hot spring and the river, they're not really backed up by archaeological and historical evidence. They're nice. They're a nice, what's the word I'm looking for? Postulation, if I'm making up words as I go, the conjecture, but they're not really what is backed up in archaeological evidence. In the same way, because Jesus mentions eye salve, people have postulated that because of their local medical school, Laodicea was center for production of an eye salve. But that also seems only to be conjecture and not supported by actual historical or archaeological evidence. There were centers of medicine also found in Smyrna and Pergamum and Ephesus, and Jesus doesn't mention anything to them about eye salve. There's also the thought that when Jesus mentions white robe, he does so to contrast the black wool that Laodicea was famous for making. And so in the same way, it is thought that the Lord's words regarding gold were calling attention to the Laodicean wealth from banking. But the Lord gives the invitation to white garments elsewhere, and he mentions wealth elsewhere as well. So what's the point? The point is that such postulation is fine, and it's usually harmless, but we must not let it alter the call of the scriptures to us. All right. And after all, most of us are not bankers or wealthy import exporters or ophthalmologists. So does it even still apply then if we don't make wool, if we don't make eye salve, if we're not bankers? Of course it applies. All right. And it would have applied to Laodicea, even if all those postulations that people come up with. And then what happens is there's this pattern, right? There's this pattern of the people come up with neat little stories that kind of add to the scriptures, and then other people grab onto them. And then after 40 years, everybody thinks it's true. One of those things, and I hesitate to bring this up because I don't want to break anybody's heart. But one of those stories is about the story of the lost sheep that Jesus went and left the 99 and go found the one and brings it back, puts it on his shoulders, bring it back. Added to that story, people will say, you know, what the shepherd used to do is they used to go and break the legs of the sheep. There is zero historical evidence for that practice. Didn't happen. It was a lack of money. You wouldn't do that because the sheep are worth money. So yeah, they would put them on their shoulders, but they wouldn't break the legs of the sheep. That people add that to the passage because they want to talk about discipline and how the lamb becomes dependent upon the shepherd that way. But it's not actually true historically. There might have been a shepherd who did it, but it's not recorded. All right, so it's a nice little story, but it doesn't really add to the passage. So again, just be cautious whenever you hear stuff like that. It might be really nice, but it's not necessarily fact. It's devotional material, all right? It's postulation, it's conjecture, all right? And so that's where the idea of the lukewarm water coming from the hot springs, getting to the city and being undrinkable comes from, all right? Another idea, and again, this is conjecture, another idea is that it reflected hospitality. That when you came to a person's house in that time, if they were a hospitable person, they would give you either mulled wine, which is hot wine. Sounds gross, but at the time it was, you know, some people even drink it today, mulled hot wine. And so they would have hot wine ready for their guests to give them hot wine, or they would have cold wine. All right. But nobody wants to drink lukewarm wine. All right. So again, that's just a conjecture. To put you know, feet on the words of Christ. So why did Jesus use these rebukes? All right. Well, it was a common part of life for ancient people. And while it may be true that the Lord was purposefully targeting different aspects of Laodicean life in order to highlight his points, it may be best just to think of conjecture as just that. It's conjecture. And we have been and will continue to use conjecture. We're not going to stop using conjecture. We're going to try to figure out what's going on. All right. But we got to remember what we're doing when we do it. All right. With all that said, let's work through the letter verse by verse. Verse 14. And to the angel of the church of Laodicea, write, The words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of God's creation. So again, it behooves us to remember that these letters are written to churches. They are addressed to the angel, but their praises and rebukes are meant first for a specific body of believers, secondarily for those who have the, for all those who have the ears to hear, right? The Amen, Jesus says, the Amen. Jesus addresses himself as the Amen. This is the same word used in the New Testament for truly, truly, or verily, verily. And I was wondering, why would he call himself that? It's a strange title for a person. Usually we say amen to something we agree with. That's something we can get behind. And when we're saying amen, in case you don't know what you're saying when you say it, you're saying that's true. That's true. That's right. So here we see Jesus using it in another way. He's saying that he is the truth. He himself is the Amen. I want you to really think about that because that is some deep stuff. He is the Amen. He is the really real. He is reality. He is the author of reality. He is the author of all truth. He did not say, I know the way, I know the truth, and I know the life. He said, I am the way, and I am the truth, and I am the life. He is not simply truthful. He does not simply do true and trustworthy things. He does not simply act in truthfulness. He is truth itself. He is the Amen. So I want us to pay close attention to this because in our time, in our culture, people, even church people, have been taught to think that truth is relative. None of us would say, I believe in relativism. But whether we recognize it or not, it's snuck its way in. It's got its foot in the door. And it's amongst us. Relativism is all around us, whether we want to recognize it or not. Now, we may not say that out loud or even think those specific words that truth is relative, but we live like that. Our comfort level and our upbringing and our tradition all impact on how we perceive truth and receive truth. I'm going to say that again because that's important. Our comfort level and our upbringing and our tradition all impact how we perceive truth and how we receive truth. And I don't want to belittle this and I don't want to weigh us down, but if we're paying attention to ourselves and to those claiming the name of Christ in our culture, we will often find that, like I said, even in ourselves, the tendency to dismiss that which is true that we don't want to receive. We find that tendency. Dismiss that which is true that we don't want to receive. Even if we know it's true, if it's hard, we look for ways to dismiss it. And on the other hand, we receive that which is false but makes us feel better. We do this with our convictions. We do this with our relationships. We do this with our self-assessment. We call something true. We consider something good, often not because it's founded in Scripture, but because we personally agree with it. Whether something makes us or the people we care about feel good has become the new standard of measurement for whether something is true or not. That is extremely dangerous and damaging. If you didn't hear that sentence, I said, whether something makes us or the people we care about feel good has become the new standard of measurement for whether something is considered true or not. My father was abusive to my mother and my siblings and even to his grandkids. And this is a rough example, all right? So I don't mean this to be as shocking as it is, but it just struck me as an example of this truth, all right? My father was abusive to my mother and to my siblings and to myself and even his grandkids. He changed somewhat after coming to Christ, but he never grew in Christ. and that refusal to grow in Christ was a very poor witness to my sister and her family, and consequently, none of the ones that live with my father have come to Christ. It's because they lived with a daily poor witness of a man who claimed Christ but looked nothing like him. Now, when my father died, what do you think was said at his funeral? What was true or what made us feel better? We said what made us feel better. We're all conditioned to do it. But hear me on this. Let me say just this. If the truth had been spoken, I think it would have been far more powerful and freeing. And you know what? If Dad really was one of the kings, he wouldn't take offense to his kids being honest at his funeral. Because now he's perfect. He's perfected. And he would want his kids to be set free and know the Lord. Even if he wasn't one of the kings. Remember the parable of Lazarus and the rich man. What does the rich man do when he's in hell? He asks for water. Well, what else does he do when he doesn't get water?
To warn his brothers.
Yep. So that I know that's a brutal example of us choosing to feel good instead of truth. I know it is, and I apologize for that, but I think it fit the illustration. There's really only one standard of truth, and it's not our understanding. It's not our own preference. It's not our own perception. Truth is truth regardless of whether we believe it or not, regardless of what we believe about it, regardless of our agreement with it or rejection of it, regardless of how it makes us feel, regardless of whether we can even perceive it or not, truth is truth. When it comes down to it, there is only one ultimate paragon, only one ultimate example, only one source of truth, and that is the Amen, Jesus the Christ. Can I get an amen on that one? Amen. And so everything that we question, everything we're wondering about, every measurement of ourselves needs to come against what? Him. The Amen. Jesus, after referring to himself as the Amen, goes on to say, he is the faithful and true witness. He sees things and reports them rightly. He himself is faithful, and he himself is true, and he himself sees, understands, and reports the truth truthfully. He says he is the beginning of God's creation. Now, this does not mean that he is God's first creation. That's not what he's talking about. Scripture teaches that Jesus is part of the Godhead and has always been with the Father. He is uncreated. Rather, John 1:3 says, all things were made through him, and without him, not anything made that was made. All right. So he is uncreated. So when we read the word beginning, then it is to be seen in that understanding. He is the creating agent. He is the source. The same word is also used in Revelation 21:6 and 22:13 to express his supremacy. That word for beginning. All right. That word for beginning in the Greek is also used. I'm going to say that again in Revelations 21:6 and 22:13. And so that word for beginning expresses his supremacy. So someone turn to Revelation 21:6 and read that for us.
Said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give from the spring of the water of life without payment.
Amen. In 22:13. If you get that, Jeff, you can do that again too. 22:13.
I am the Alpha and Omega, first and the last, the beginning and the end.
Amen. So that word beginning expresses his supremacy. He is the Alpha and Omega, beginning and the end. He is creator and Lord. He is the way and the truth and the life. So without getting too far into speculation, is there any clue in this letter to the Laodiceans as to why Jesus would introduce himself in such a way? Why would he emphasize his ultimate authority, his identity as the prime reality and source of truth? Why would he identify himself as the really real? What do you think? To this church in particular, why do you think? Because in every single situation, every single church we read, Jesus introduces himself on purpose in the way he does. So why is he doing this with Laodicea? Why do you think? Go ahead, Pam. That's really good. Good. Amen. Anyone else? Go ahead, Sharon.
If you really believe that he is the amen, the faithful, and true witness, the beginning of God's creation, there's no way you can be lukewarm.
Amen.
And obviously, they don't get it. They don't
Yeah. Amen. That's good. I saw a hand back there, too.
I didn't hear what she said. No way what?
There's no way you can be lukewarm. If you really believe that.
I was just going to say, if he was with God in the beginning, the same was in the beginning with God. He was the spoken word before the word was become flesh. So he was before all man-made gods like Zeus, the Roman gods, the Greek gods, Assyrian gods, Babylonian gods. He was before all that man-made stuff. So if you want to get the truth about God and God, what God expects, get it from Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen. That's good. So let's go a little bit further. So verse 15 says, I know your works, that you are neither cold nor hot. Would that you were either cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spit you out of my mouth. And that word spit is vomit, all right? Spew, all right? It's a violent expulsion, all right? So notice Jesus did not say that he prefers one over the other. There's no mention here of water. The speculation regarding water of Laodicea being lukewarm might be true, even though archaeological evidence seems to say otherwise. Again, I'm just going to cover this again. One thing we know for sure about lukewarm water is it's not pleasing to drink or useful for consumption as cold or hot water. Cold slows the growth of bacteria. Hot temperatures kill bacteria. But the archaeological evidence that the water of Laodicea was pleasing to drink was a pillar that held up the aqueduct, and the words sweet water are written on that pillar. So it could be assumed that the water was good to drink, but it also might have been just an ancient commercial, you know, and that wasn't really true. Just a way to sell the product, I guess. But there's also some historical precedence that, I mentioned this about the wine that someone would serve a guest chilled or mulled wine. So most commentators teach, however, that it is zeal that Jesus is speaking of here. And he mentions zeal, actually, later on in his encouragement to Laodicea. And so most commentators teach that it is zeal that Jesus is speaking of here, and that has been the most traditionally understood way of looking at his words here. But with that assumption is the idea that Jesus is saying here that he would rather that these Christians totally forsake him than to wax in their commitment to him. And this idea seems to disagree. Now, I'm just kind of wanting to get your juices flowing. This idea seems to disagree with Jesus says in Sardis. He says to Sardis, strengthen what remains and is about to die. So if zeal is the issue here, as is most commonly assumed, because we associate heat with passion, if zeal is speaking of zeal, then our Lord here is saying that he would rather the Christian forsake him utterly than to be ho-hum, so-so with their faith. So why on earth would that be? If that's actually what the Lord is saying, why would that be?
If they are cold, they can be made to warm up. Mm-hmm. They're reachable. Because when you are cold, that means you really don't know. Mm-hmm. You haven't seen yet. Lukewarm gives the idea of, I know, but I'm apathetic, mm-hmm. and in my luxury, well, who cares? Mm-hmm. There's no passion, there's no zeal, and it comes from, it's like being vaccinated against the disease.
Mm-hmm. It is, yeah, that's good.
If you get the disease, you have all the evidence of the disease. I hate to call Christianity or faith in Christ a disease, but it is kind of like that. You
yeah.
have just enough of it.
That's good.
To keep you from actually catching on fire.
That's actually a really good illustration. Yeah, good.
I was just going to say, if they are neither hot nor cold, he's speaking to a church.
Mm-hmm.
So they should have a witness
mm-hmm.
to others around them.
Mm-hmm.
And if others are looking on and they're not seeing any difference in those within the church as far as lifestyle or even concern for others, that's kind of a pretty sad example, and why would anyone even wish to seek that out?
That's good.
It's kind of like church in America today. If you live just like your neighbor who has never been to church ever, and has no desire ever, and will not allow you to even speak the name of Christ, and then you're living exactly the same way, then what's the point, really?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Go ahead, Dennis.
Looking ahead, I think, tends to reinforce
mm-hmm.
the interpretation Karen was giving, that the problem with these types is that they're self-deluded.
Mm-hmm.
They think they got it.
Yep.
And they don't. Again, this is a vaccinated against Christ.
That's good. That's good. Thank you. So look at the ministry of Jesus. All right. Let's take a trip back 30 years. All right. And let's look at the ministry, or 60 years. And let's look at the ministry of Christ. All right. Who did Jesus praise as the greatest man ever born of woman other than himself? Who?
John
the Baptist. Surely an example of being on fire for the Lord, of being zealous. But who did Jesus spend much of his time reaching out to? Actually, the majority of his time reaching out to.
The rich, the powerful.
No. Not just, no. Jesus spent most of his time reaching out to the poor, the people, the sinners, the drunkards. He said, I came eating and drinking, and surely you will call me a drunkard.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. Who did he have? Okay, now. And he was criticized for that, was he not?
Yeah.
So who did he have the most difficulty with?
The rich,
religious, powerful, self-righteous,
the vaccinated.
All right. All right. The sinners, the sick, the wounded, the needy, many of whom could have been described as cold in their relationship with God or lack thereof. Those are the ones that Jesus went to. But those who were self-righteous, who were vaccinated, those are the ones who resisted him the most. And I think the same pattern is alive and well in us today. What is self-righteousness? It is believing oneself to be righteous by one's own system of measurement. It is thus necessarily an elevation of not just oneself, but one's own system of moral measurement over all others. And the self-righteous are the people who see in Scripture, who we see in Scripture that have the most difficult time with Jesus. Jesus is the gift of God, but you can only receive that gift if you acknowledge your own desperate need of that gift. That is why sharing the gospel is so much more difficult and typically less effective when the one you share with has been raised in a religious or a moral home. Or when they have been taught by their family or community that they are good and that their way of thinking is right. Self-righteousness is very apparent in the movements and the worldly culture of today. And unfortunately, it's even growing in the church. This is why, you know, the moral issues aside, this is what makes the LGBTQ movement so incredibly dangerous. What God says is immoral. Set that aside for the sake of this argument. What makes that movement dangerous is they say, I am good as I am, and I have no need to change. And if you think I ought to, you are the one that needs to change. And you are the one who is no longer good. That's what makes that movement so difficult. And I'm telling you, I don't care where that idea is, whether it's found on the left or it's found on the right or it's found, whether found on the streets or whether it's found in church. Self-righteousness is anti-gospel. And that's what Jesus is confronting in Laodicea. And we're going to see more of that next week. So let's pray. Lord Jesus, we come before you and Lord, we want to recognize just how weak, how pitiable, how wretched we are without you. Without you, Lord, we are lost. Without you, Lord, we are less than dust. For it is you who took dust and formed man. And Father, we want to come before you and confess, even now, as we just looked at your word for a few minutes, Lord, we want to confess our own self-delusion, our own self-deception, our own self-righteousness. Father, give us the grace to hear truth and not just hear it, but receive it. Even when we're afraid of it, even when it seems unpleasant, we know that only by the truth are we set free. And so, Father, give us the ears to hear what your Spirit is saying to us. And may we be pillars with your name written on us for the world to see because we have been set free. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, everyone.